Now, Siouxsie, welcome to Belgium. To start on a classic note, how do you feel about your new album that's just come out a few days ago?
Like it should have been out last year.
Why?
Just because of silly problems like producers getting in our way. Really, that's really the only reason why it's taken so long coming out. We recorded it in May in Berlin, and we came back to London to finish it off and mix it. The producer ended up being sacked for his incompetence. He just seems fine for the recording, but he just seemed to fall to pieces when it came to putting the jigsaw pieces together.
Do you feel comfortable selling yourself as a product, as something that has to be sold so many units?
No, I let the record company businessmen think about the units. We don't particularly bother or count units. I mean, it's especially a preferable situation to most people because we're involved in it in every aspect of making a record, i.e. the artwork and the video and everything else. So it's not just us doing the music and having to sit back and let other people design it and market it. We actually take a hand in how it looks and how it comes across.
How did you feel when you lost John McGough?
McGough.
Sorry.
Probably it was just as well. I mean, he was a great guitarist. Again, we seem to bring out the best in people and then use them up like a sponge until they've got nothing much left to give, I suppose. I don't know. We tend to go through guitarists uncommonly, often.
You mean you're some kind of vampire? Are you?
If you want to be comical, yes.
Do they think they actually know you at all? Do you feel when you read something about yourself, oh yes, this is me, or do you feel?
No, never. I mean, it's always someone's interpretation or someone's impression of what they've seen and heard. And most of those people in that situation rarely go to the actual concerts and rarely see how it works. So,
do you feel it important or necessary to keep Siouxsie that goes home in the night time and is nothing like the Siouxsie that we see on television? Or is it one and the same person?
Well, it's one and the same, but except I feel the need for privacy when I do go home. That's all. Blah, blah, blah.
Are you a lot calmer now than you used to be, as you're getting older? As we all are.
Yes, it's the old heart, you know. With this pacemaker in, I have to watch myself, you know. Suppose I'm just more controlled for my benefit. I mean, I wouldn't say I'm calmer when it isn't required. It's, I don't wind myself up for no reason so much and like put my foot through a glass window by accident and hurt myself. I mean, I tend to check myself before I do that, unless it's really necessary. Dink, dink, dink.
Yeah.
What is this black magic?
Does it fascinate you really, or are you just playing with it?
No, I'm not playing with it. It's, I suppose I'm fascinated in all aspects of religions, and the black magic is another religion, that's all.
Do you feel that there's an evil and a good?
Yes, I think there is an evil and a good.
Have you ever gone any further?
How do you mean?
By actually,
have I ever met?
No, have you actually practiced with the Ouija board or anything?
No,
like that?
I have a respect for things that I don't understand, so I wouldn't mess around with it. I think that's wise, unless you know what you're doing. I've heard of some strange stories of people who have dabbled and people who have been involved in very strange sects and been a bit, how do you say, indiscreet about it, and they've wound it up dead in a motorway crash or something.
But does the power of evil interest you, or is it the whole sect, as you say, the whole
religion? No, as I say, just the whole religion, including all other. I mean, there's amazing religions in the East where they go into states of dervishes and they put skewers through there. I don't know what that's called. It's like they go into mad dervishes and through chanting and mantras and that. And I'm just fascinated in the power of the mind over the body, I suppose. And what's outside, not just the mind, just what other elements are involved in that you can endure incredible amount of pain without faltering. Again, when, you know, the adrenaline and the drive is pushed.
Mm-hmm. So we can now reveal that Susie's not really a witch after all, then?
No.
What, how did you feel this week, on Tuesday, when the Americans finally...
Well, we were in Paris then, doing just some TV and press. And it was a bit worrying, just not really understanding the interpretation that was being given about what was happening. And it seemed like, you know, it possibly could be World War III starting, and it was a bit panicky. I was ready to sort of, you know, just get drunk or something. But, I don't know, I suppose it diffused itself. I mean, Gaddafi diffused it, and I think seemed to make Mr. Reagan look very silly. It was very clever of him,
but
I think.
You did feel very worried.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
As we all do.
Yeah.
What do you think you would do?
Have a drink. Yes. I mean, you know, if it was a matter of hours or minutes, I mean, God, you know, I just drink myself to oblivion rather than be blown to oblivion. Mm. I think that would, I'd certainly regret it if I died sober.
And what are the things closest to your heart now?
What,
in
things?
1986, yeah.
Still Cats. Prince, pretty fab.
You've yet to really fall in love and go off.
Oh yes, I'm in love.
You're in love?
Mm.
Good.
The East. I like the East. Indonesia, well, Bali or Singapore, places like that.
You're Belgian somewhere in your blood, aren't
yes,
you?
Yes, I'm demi-Belge.
Demi-Belge?
Mm.
And can you speak any French? You can.
No.
So what about...
Je parle pas français.
Do I parle français? What do you know, and what would you say to someone if you... Could you sort of speak a bit of French and show me the love and the hate side of Susie? Can you do that in French? The sort of the two differences, because French is a very spoken sun language.
Mm.
Could you say a few words?
A few words, what? A good side and a
bad side. And a bad side, the nice and the evil side of Susie.
Enchanté. And, allez au diable. Sarcastic.
Yeah.
Mm.
In what way? Aren't we all having a good time?
In a way, you know, like television, all the media is like adverts, advertising is the perfect family, you know, whereas it's more common that, you know, husbands beat their wives.
The mental families.
You know, they're all mental families, really. But, like, the projection is that everyone's smiling, blonde hair, sunshine, eating butter without fat. You know, and everyone perfect.
Yeah. What happened to your voice last year? I think last spring.
Yeah, I've been overworking, and it was in a tour of Scandinavia, and I was very ill. I was like coughing up blood and I couldn't talk. And and I saw a specialist in Lund, I think it was. And he said, kaput, finished.
Yeah.
Unless you sing like Sheena Easton, then you will never have a voice again. And until we got back to London, everyone was worried. But...
yeah, that was what I read in the music press here, but in the meantime, I think you recorded another album, so...
Yeah, I mean, I just had a rest for a few weeks, and... doctors, they're all quacks.
We'd already recorded some tracks for Because in the Dream House, so we had things to work on while Susie was taking a rest.
Yeah.
If you like, I mean... So nothing. Yeah. We weren't really delighted, if you like anything.
You and your band don't like to be identified with either punk or any wave. Why?
It's like we're in the rock business, which we don't like to feel a part of. And like, if we say, yes, we're a rock and roll band, that's like we're alongside with Bruce Springsteen or Leonard Skinner, or which is doesn't describe us at all. We're definitely nothing like that.
We retain our own identity within it.
Yeah. Where did you get the inspiration for Christine?
That's about an actual person. Steve wrote the lyric, but it's something that was only written a long time after both him and me saw a program about a woman called Christine Sizemore.
Really existing?
Yeah, and she had a slight problem. She had 22 different personalities in her lifetime.
A very magical atmosphere, mysterious, and so. Why do you like that kind of atmosphere?
What a letdown.
I mean, that's the image I had before. I thought very strange is going to come in here.
Well, even magical people have two flat tires on the way here.
We were going to fly.
That's why we're so late. The magic that. We want is not textbook magic. I mean, we use terms like voodoo or spellbound, but they're not to be taken literally. The best magic is when something good happens and you don't plan it. It's not in your control. To an extent you're in control, but to be totally in control of everything, then that would be boring. Life would be boring if nothing went, you know, something's magic happened, but it's not like that. It's a feeling.
What's the next logical step with the next album? I mean, this album, A Kiss in the Dream House. What makes this album different from the previous ones?
half of it, or over half of it, was created very spontaneously in the studio and working from sounds of things and images and words like circle.
Do you sometimes improvise lyrics in the studio?
Slow Dive was an improvised lyric.
Well, Steve went in and was just getting a sound on the bass guitar, on a six-string bass. Mm-hmm. He was just playing
around
with
it. He'd never played six-string before.
And Mike Hedges and myself were in the studio, and I just turned to put the tape on. We taped it. Steve came in and listened. I went out and joined him. Just about 10 minutes of just that one chord, if you like. And you went out and wrote some lyrics, just on hearing it.
Just hearing it, and I was writing them down, saying, let me in and sing.
And that was it.
But you can't reveal the key to Slow Dive.
If you're making music, you're making it because you're expressing something that you can't say in words. Mm-hmm. So for me to explain what that is taking away something that you lose when you say, when you're just using speech. With music, it should speak for itself.
Okay. I was a bit afraid when I came here that I would not recognize you when you wouldn't wear makeup. But you wear some. Is this makeup important to you?
Yeah, I suppose it is. Something I've always done.
Yeah.
Gotta put your face on, do you? Yeah. Mm.
Some people, it's important for them to take a laxative. I like to put on makeup.
But now you've simplified your makeup. Why?
It's casual.
Yeah.
I only slept for 2 hours. Smith Odeon towards the end of the show.
Does the split bit and goes, so Siouxsie is in a hole. But London Calling tracked her down recently as she was frantically rehearsing with her new guitarist. Wave.
Hi, babe.
Hi.
We're rehearsing here for the eve of another tour in which another guitarist has bitten the dust, which is Robert Smith, and we're preparing someone else to die shortly. John Carruthers, John Valentine Carruthers to be precise, is the new guitarist. And he's from a Sheffield-based group called Clock DVA, who aren't doing anything too much at the moment because they've sacked their singer. Yes, it was special playing the Royal Albert Hall. It's getting increasingly difficult to play in London without playing the Hammersmith Palais or the Hammersmith Odeon. And when you've played those places 2 years in a row, 3 years in a row, 4 years in a row, it's like going home to see your mother or something. So finding an alternative and somewhere special like that was a big event.
Rock and roll,
I go mad if we don't haven't played live for a while. I go mad when we've played live for a long time and get sick of the idea of living out of a suitcase and not being anywhere or just feeling tired, I suppose. But then when, I don't know, probably after a week or two of being back home and not having that thing to do, it's a very addictive drug, I suppose. Mm. And my system screams out when I don't take it for a while. Oh, you're asking me about my interest in Eastern singing as opposed to anything Western. I don't think it's obvious I've tried to emulate it, but I'm sure I must have been influenced in just using the voice more, I suppose. Because I think Western way of singing is very predictable. And I think Eastern singing is, the Latin is very, it's not solid, it snakes along and finds different corners and it's very emotional, more emotional, I suppose. More akin to crying or something, or sobbing. I mean, on the new album, there's a lot of Eastern instruments on it, a lot of very, you know, those raw, the sort of trumpets, the flutes, just because they have those scales that aren't shut up, you kids, wherever you are. Just to compliment the music that we were interested in and we were playing. I never liked thinking of videos being literal visuals of what the song is. Just in that lyric, anyway, there was a lot of visual ideas, not situation ideas, but a lot of words were very visual, so it was very easy to get away from it being descriptive of a story or anything, because it's not really a story, it's just feeling.
Gone to the darkness.